Hello, I'm Paul, a student at Hillsdale College. Here is my professor, Dr. Larry Arn, on the separation of church and state.
America's founders believed in a separation of church and state, in that the country was not to have an official religion or an official sect. But that did not mean that government was to be hostile to religion, or even indifferent to religion, as many today argue. In fact, America's founding document, the Declaration of Independence, includes both a reference to God as the author of the laws of nature and a confident assertion that human beings are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Far from being hostile or indifferent to religion, America's founders understood the theology of the Declaration to be an essential part of the education of citizens.
This Constitution Minute was brought to you by Hillsdale College. To join the national conversation on the Constitution, go to constitutionminute.org.
In a world controlled by corrupt politicians.
You got a business. That you didn't build that.
A team of ordinary men emerge from the ashes to give voice to the voiceless and hope to the hopeless. Sackhead Sean.
Dude, I'm not saying Cap was stupid, bro.
Sackhead Clint.
All good friends of ours usually show up drunk.
Also starring Socko as the producer.
I'm a little bit drunk, I'm a little bit drunk, cause I'm drinking.
They are the Sackheads Radio Show. Every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific on shrmedia.com.
Roughly 20,000 comedies over the river.
And all the bridge, we can defend Dong Ha.
We will fly in Dong Ha, and we will die in Dong Ha.
This is not a prison. This is the re-education camp.
The communists always try to break us.
Bring teachers here to teach you. Proper communist way to live.
Still show no gratitude! Get up!
But they will never break me.
Ride the Thunder, coming soon to a theater near you. For more information, visit RideTheThunderMovie.com.
Afternoon to everybody out on the East Coast. Good morning to everyone on the West Coast and everywhere in between. Of course, you are listening to The Edge of Liberty live from the Time for Heroes studio. broadcasting as part of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network from WNJC 1360 AM in Philadelphia and around the world on the internet. And I am your humble host for today, Dan Butcher. I am the editor-in-chief of Pundit Press. You can visit my website at punditpress.com. And for those of you expecting to hear Sean Lewis today, Sean is on vacation for the next couple of days, actually the next 3 days if you count Monday on Memorial Day. So I will be with you again on Friday like I normally am, and then we'll have a replay of the Edge of Liberty on Monday. We're all going to take the day off on Memorial Day. I'd like to also remind everybody that you can listen to my own show. I will be coming back on the air with my own show beginning actually on Monday on Memorial Day. My show is News and Commentary with Dan Butcher, and the show will air Monday through Friday at 7 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. So for all of you early birds that get up early and get ready for work, that is where I'm going to be for you to listen to my show. Of course, that will be 6 a.m. Central Standard Time, right, as everybody's getting up, getting the kids ready for work, school, and getting off to start the work day. So I hope that you join me. The show will air on, of course, my home website at Pundit Press, as well as SHR Media. And so I'm looking very forward to being back on the air on a regular basis with my own show. I've been doing my own show just kind of intermittent here for the last year and a half since we launched the new version of Pundit Press and everything. So it's going to be really good to get back into the groove of doing my own show again. And I'm really, really looking forward to it. So you know what? Let's just, you know, I have got a lot to talk about today, and if everybody's been listening to me, especially on my own show for the last 6+ years, know that I'm very seldom short for words. This is funny. You know, I came on Sean's show yesterday. If you were listening, you know, Sean called me. I'll give him credit. He texted me about an hour before showtime, said, "Hey, can you come on today?" And then I got back to him, about 2 minutes before showtime. And then ended up being on for the entire hour. But it was a lot of fun. I really enjoy, working with Sean and doing the show with him. So it's always a pleasure when he and I get to banter around, especially for a full hour. You get a kind of a sense of what about what we're like behind the scenes too. Because I'll tell you, what you hear on the air is pretty well what you get in person with us. Especially me, I don't mix any words. I'm very honest and open, and I like to have a good time, but I'm also very serious about the issues and what's facing our country today. And so we're going to get into a lot of that today. And all of this stuff involving Hillary Clinton just continues to just magnify, and we're certainly seeing the liberal media protect her. Reporters actually finally had a chance to ask her some questions. And you would not, they were softball questions. Ed Henry from Fox News had tried to get a question in with her at a little event she was having, but she shut him off, said, "I'll take it under consideration." In most cases, I'll tell you right now, if you submit a press inquiry to Hillary Clinton's campaign, they say that we will get back to you within 48 to 72 hours with your request. But, finally some reporters had some opportunity to ask her some questions, and quite honestly, they didn't ask her anything, not a single thing about what's going on, with the Clinton Foundation, Benghazi, anything like that. And, so today we have breaking that some of the leaked emails have confirmed that Hillary Clinton had highly sensitive information on her private email sensor. Now, these emails were leaked to the New York Times. And as we have all suspected, especially those in the conservative media, her private email server was very insecure. Now, here's what the New York Times reported. They said, "Mrs. Clinton's emails show that she had a special type of government information known as Sensitive but Unclassified, or SBU, on her account. That information included the whereabouts and travel plans of American officials in Libya as security there deteriorated during the uprising against the leadership of Colonel Muammar Gaddafi in 2011. Ladies and gentlemen, you can see where this is going. I will remind everybody that Hillary Clinton has been subpoenaed to appear before the House Select Committee on Benghazi. She's got a lot of questions to answer. So now you're starting to see how all of this is tying together with her private email server, with Benghazi. You have to remember, she said so famously, "What does it matter?" Well, Hillary, you're fixing to find out why it matters, because it's starting to come out. And thankfully, of all things, because, you know, let's face it, and I'm going to put it, the majority of the liberal media are lofting softballs at Hillary, and they are covering for her. But we are starting to see some chinks in the armor with some of the more notorious liberal media outlets, such as the New York Times, really starting to question Hillary, because they know that, you know what, there's a lot at stake here as far as our country is concerned. Now, this goes on to say that one of these very sensitive emails was actually from Ambassador Chris Stevens. Now, I will put the image in your head, because I keep beating away at this, and I keep repeating this over and over again, and I want this image to sink into everybody's head. And that is the image of Ambassador Stevens being dragged through the streets after he was murdered. Matter of fact, he was still alive at some point, being dragged through the streets, his body being dragged through the streets by these terrorists. And then the other three Americans that were killed as a result of this terrorist attack. I often say this, Hillary Clinton has blood on her hands when it comes to the Benghazi terror attack. And you know what? We don't know how far this goes up. We know that President Obama went to bed and then went to a campaign event in Las Vegas the next day and went golfing, whatever, whatever. But, you know, so hopefully we'll start to see how much others in the administration were involved with this. But once again, one of these sensitive emails came from Ambassador Chris Stevens. Put that image in your head. Put it in your head of him being dragged through the streets after he was viciously attacked and murdered. I want that image in your heads. But this was the email. The New York Times said, nearly a year and a half before the attacks in Benghazi, Mr. Stevens, then an American envoy to the rebels, considered leaving Benghazi, citing deteriorating security, according to an email to Mrs. Clinton marked SBU. Now, we do know that Ambassador Stevens, in the weeks and days leading up to that attack, was actually requesting more security at the consulate in Benghazi because of concerns. Now, we're also having reports coming out about the gun-running activities. We know that the Obama administration, and particularly the Secretary of State, the State Department, they were very aware of what was going on. And I have a feeling that so did Mr. Stevens, and he was requesting more security. And at this time, that request was ignored. As a matter of fact, security was being laxed and relaxed at embassies around the world at this time. And it led to the death of a United States ambassador and three other innocent Americans. Folks, the death and murder and assassination of a U.S. ambassador is a big deal. It is a major event. It is a major. You have to remember, the U.S. consulate, that is a direct attack on U.S. soil, on U.S. sovereignty, on U.S. freedom. But yet, Hillary Clinton, President Obama, the entire administration, they have blown this off. They have shoved it to the side. Oh, you know what? It was just another thing. You know what? It was just, you know, hey, it was probably just another case of workplace violence. Oh, wait a minute. They blame this on a video, remember? just like they blamed the terror attack in Fort Hood, Texas, that left so many dead. They declared that as a case of civil case of workplace violence. So you can see how all of this is coming together. Now, Hillary Clinton said at a press conference at the United Nations earlier this year, quote, there were no security breaches of her private email server. Folks, now we know she was lying. You have to remember, Fox News did a report where they actually interviewed some professional hackers and who had this to say. They said major security lapses they found would have made it child's play for highly trained hackers of foreign governments to obtain the whereabouts of U.S. officials in war-torn Libya. The New York Times also went on to report and said, Mrs. Clinton was circulating information about the attacks in Benghazi that contradicted the Obama administration's initial narrative of what occurred, and that she was, quote, concerned about how Republicans could use the incidents to undermine President Obama. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, that this terror attack, they wanted to make sure that this went away. They wanted to cover this up as much as they could because this could have cost Barack Obama the White House in 2012. So now all of the pieces of the puzzle are starting to come together. And that is why those of us in the conservative media have got to continue looking around every corner, looking under every crack. And then now we're starting to see some of our counterparts in the liberal media. They're starting to say, hey, wait a minute, something is not right here. A focus group of Iowa Democrats. Now, this focus group was conducted by Bloomberg's Mark Halperin. And during this, Mark asked the participants to name a single accomplishment by Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State. Now, not a single one of the participants could name an accomplishment by Hillary Clinton. Well, I can name one: the death of Ambassador Chris Stevens. How about that? But the point being made is, and I will issue this challenge to everybody listening to this show today. And if you want to call in, let me give you, because I do have my own call-in number for my show, because I am using my studio to broadcast. But if you would like to take my challenge, please call me. The area code is 516-666-9908. Once again, that number is 516-666-9908. Now, here's my challenge before I go to the break. I challenge anybody out there. I don't care if you're a member of Hillary Clinton's staff, if you're a supporter of Hillary Clinton, if you have voted for Hillary Clinton, you think Hillary Clinton's the greatest thing since sliced bread, whatever. But I'm going to ask you this challenge to you. Give me a call. I'm going to say, tell me one thing. Name one single positive accomplishment that Hillary Clinton did while she was Secretary of State of the United States of America. One positive accomplishment. Now, I will even go further than that. Let's go further than that. Over her entire political career, 20-plus years, name one. Even going back to her days as a senator from the state of New York in the U.S. Senate, name one accomplishment. Name one accomplishment, one positive accomplishment that Hillary Clinton has ever done in her entire political career. I'm expanding on that, not just as Secretary of State and her service into the disaster that we now know as the Obama administration. I'm going to issue the challenge for her entire political career, going all the way back to when she was a United States Senator from New York. Name one positive accomplishment by Hillary Clinton. Name one. And I'm just waiting for the first person that says, oh, the Clinton Foundation. Really? Bring that one up. Well, folks, once again, you are listening to The Edge of Liberty on WNJC 1360 AM in Philadelphia. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in about 2.5 minutes.
In a world controlled by corrupt politicians.
You got a business. That you didn't build that.
A team of ordinary men emerge from the ashes to give voice to the voiceless and hope to the hopeless. Sackhead Sean.
Dude, I'm not saying Cap was stupid, bro.
Sackhead Clint.
All good friends of ours usually show up drunk.
Also starring Socko. As the producer.
I'm a little bit drunk, I'm a little bit drunk, cause I'm drinking.
They are the Sackheads Radio Show. Every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific on shrmedia.com.
I'm Jason Miller from the Evan Miller Report. Each weeknight, I take you around the world with the latest in world news and politics. Not the least of which what's going on in good old Washington, D.C. In short, I'm telling you what the government doesn't want me to.
Join me, Corey Evans, and Jason Miller for the Evan Miller Report, weeknights at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on shrmedia.com. Also on the iHeartRadio.
This is Tammy Jackson, inviting you to join me on the Tammy Jackson Show every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific on 405radio.com. Put down that remote and tune into the show that covers politics, guns and the Second Amendment, religious liberty, sanctity of life, the military, and more. I host newsworthy guests and work hard to be a conservative radio show that's not like all the others. So save Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific for me, Tammy Jackson, on 405media.com.
I'd like to welcome everybody back to the Edge of Liberty on WNJC 1360 AM. And, of course, I am Dan Butcher, the editor-in-chief of Pundit Press, and you can visit my website at punditpress.com. Once again, I want to issue that challenge, and I have expanded upon, and this is a challenge that I've had for a long time going right now that nobody has taken me up yet on the air. And once again, the original challenge was to name one positive accomplishment by Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State of the United States of America. I've expanded upon that. Please name one positive accomplishment by Hillary Clinton during her entire political career. Name one. One positive accomplishment. And if you'd like to take me up on my challenge, the number is area code 516-666-9908, and I am anxiously awaiting your phone call. Now, you have to remember, our friends on the liberal left now consider it sexist to refer to Hillary Clinton as Hillary. We should be calling her Mrs. Clinton, Hillary Rodham. I've even heard some people say it's sexist to call her Hillary Clinton. We should be calling her Hillary Rodham Clinton. Secretary Clinton is the big one I hear. We need to refer to her as Secretary Clinton to show how official she is and how important she is. Former First Lady Clinton, something like that. Well, I'm going to call or Hillary for the benefit of this show. And if you'd like to call me sexist, please do so at the same number that I just gave out. Now, I want to bring this up because I was mentioning the focus group, the Iowa focus group earlier. Now, excuse me just a second here. U.S. News and World Report's Susan Milligan, she was on Hardball on May the 20th, of course, with Chris Matthews on a network that nobody ever watches, MSNBC. But I did find this interesting because she was basically during this conversation, she was saying that it was unfair to expect Hillary Clinton supporters to name any of her accomplishments as Secretary of State. So I guess I am being very unfair today, by criticizing, I'm being unfair and sexist, I guess, for criticizing and questioning Hillary's qualifications to be President of the United States when she has none other than being a failed U.S. Senator from New York and a failed former Secretary of State in a failed administration under Barack Obama. Those are her actual accomplishments, and I don't think those are very positive. So once again, it's very unfair, according to Susan Milligan of U.S. News and World Report, to question such things of Hillary Clinton. And just to give you a little bit of background on the conversation started out with Chris Matthews asking, "What do you make of that?" And he was referring to the focus group. And Perry Bacon, who's a Washington Post reporter, said, "I think that's good. I think they're saying that she's ambitious. She's confident. They're confident in her. I think it's good." People in that question and answer also were not sure what was her biggest accomplishment. So I think she does need to add on and say, "Here are the things that I've done already." Well, she has nothing to say. That's why she is running and hiding from the press. She has nothing to run on. She has nothing to say. That is why she lost in 2008 during the Democratic primary to Barack Obama. For goodness sakes, ladies, so she had nothing to run on then. She has nothing to run on now. Now, Matthews went on to say, "Hey, Obama didn't have a big accomplishment before he got elected. Well, hell, look where that's gotten us." You know, he was a failed state senator in the state of Illinois who was very rarely there for vote. If he did vote, he voted present. He was a failed United States senator from the state of Illinois. Now he's a failed United States president. The reason is he had not ever done anything other than be a community organizer. Now, that brings us back to Hillary. If we want to compare, if we're going to use Obama as the model for this, by all means, let's do it. And let's show the truth and show how this has been a complete and utter failure. So then Susan Milligan from U.S. News and World Report came in and said, "As most secretaries, you know, most people, when they ask what accomplishment did she have as Secretary of State, I think most people could not look at a Secretary of State and point at an accomplishment. Frankly, mostly what a Secretary of State does is keep something from, you know, becoming massive crisis. So that, in a way, wasn't, you know, a terribly fair question." Okay, let's address that for just a second. If we're going to use Susan Milligan's comment here and say, "Oh, you know what? Hillary Clinton, her greatest accomplishment as Secretary of State is nothing happened. Everybody could sing Kumbaya. You know, she went around the world very quietly putting out fires." Okay. What do we have today, ladies and gentlemen? We have Vlad the Impaler, Vladimir Putin in Russia, who has this grand dream, this big scheme, and he's well on his way to bringing the old Soviet Union back together. You have to remember, Hillary Clinton said, "Hey, is she really touted this? We've set the reset button with Russia." Okay, well, we definitely set a reset with them because they're trying to get back all of the territory they had as the Soviet Union. Now, let's look at the Middle East. What do we have today? Complete and utter chaos. ISIS, despite what – let's say we'd use the term ISIS. Let's call them what they are, the Islamic State. They are running rapid. You know, the Obama administration recently asked media outlets, hey, please quit showing the videos and pictures of these big, massive Islamic State troops moving around, because that's not the truth. You know, we've made some advances, and we've been able to fight them back. That's not what's happening. Folks, Ramadiya just fell. That is a major accomplishment. That is a major success for the Islamic State. But yet the Obama administration continues to say, hey, everything is fine. We're making goes. We're stopping them. We're not stopping them. We're running away from them. President Obama and this administration, they do not want to engage and do not want to do anything to stop the Islamic State. They don't want to do anything that might offend Iran and blow up this what is going to be an absolutely disastrous nuclear deal with this country. We're basically giving Iran, which is the largest supplier and supporter of terrorism in the world, a gift-wrapped nuclear bomb. And then that comes to, you know, let's use Yemen as another example. You know, the Obama administration continues to cite Yemen as a success. They use this, they call it a success, and how the Obama administration has dealt with terrorism around the world. Have they actually looked to see what's happening in Yemen? You have to remember, our own people, U.S. citizens in Yemen, were told by the Obama administration, hey, guess what? We're not going to come get you. You're going to have to find your own way out of here. We're not going to help you in any way. Good luck to you. Wouldn't want to be you. It was the Saudis who were helping get our own citizens out of there. Other countries were getting our citizens out of Yemen, which, by the way, the Obama administration, to this very day, to today, to doing this show now, claims to be a model of success. And that all goes back to everything that was started under Secretary Hillary Clinton, because John Kerry is simply carrying on the same policies that were put in place by Hillary Clinton at the beginning of the Obama administration when she was Secretary of State. So they're continuing on her policies, one failure after another, which has become synonymous with this administration. Now, once again, if you'd like to take me up on my challenge today, and I'm anxiously awaiting your phone call. And remember, I have expanded my challenge to include not only Hillary Clinton's disastrous term as Secretary of State, but her entire political career. Name one positive accomplishment by Hillary Clinton during her entire political career, going back to being a United States Senator to Secretary of State. You know what? Let's even throw being First Lady in there, okay? Let's throw in, you know, when she was the First Lady of Arkansas. Let's just throw all that in. We know about all of the disasters and all of the scandals that followed the Clintons to the White House from Arkansas, and then all of the scandals that followed them out of the White House. You have to remember, when they left the White House, hey, we're dead broke. They actually took stuff from the White House that didn't belong to them. I guess they held a big rummage sale with some of that stuff, you know, whatever they did with it to help pay the bills. You know, you're talking about a couple that, you know, during their recent report had made over $20 million doing speeches alone. And of course, you know, we have a lot of questions dealing with the funds with the Clinton Foundation. You know, where is all that money gone? Where is all that money gone that was supposed to go to Haiti, to the Haiti relief effort? Where is all that money gone? Where is it? There's a lot of questions that have to be answered. And she has a lot of, and hopefully you know, as we start getting into the campaign, into the debates, and as more of these candidates on the Democratic side, because we know that Martin O'Malley is going to jump into this. Bernie Sanders is already into this. And there's some other people, Cuomo from New York might jump into this as well. And so she's going to have to answer some questions in the debates because, you know, there's a lot of people, even within her own party that are starting to scratch their heads, just like they did in 2008. Hillary Clinton is damaged goods. And I'm not going to say for the Democratic Party, but for the United States of America. She is not what our country needs in the form of leadership. She is not what our country needs in the form of a role model, of being a model to success. You know, a lot of our friends on the liberal left say, you know what, it's more important to elect the first woman president. And they see that Hillary Clinton is the best option for that at this point in time. Well, you know, many people said that it was very important to elect the first African-American president in 2008. Well, you know what? I will not begrudge Barack Obama because, you know, Barack Obama being elected the first African-American president in our country's history is a big deal. It is an accomplishment for him that he should be very proud of. It's an accomplishment that our country should be proud of. But the bottom line is the guy has been an absolute disaster as president of the United States. So now we come to, is it important to elect the first woman president, or is it more important to put our country back on the correct path, back on a path of financial stability, back on a path of moral stability for our children and grandchildren? You know, I've often said that, you know, this upcoming election in 2016 is for the very moral soul of our country. And is somebody like Hillary Clinton the one to lead our country? I don't think so. Do you really want Bill Clinton to be the quote-unquote, you know, first man or whatever we're going to call him? And then you're looking, we've seen some reports that, you know, that Chelsea Clinton could actually come in and be the act as the role of the first lady in a Hillary Clinton presidency. And every one of the Clintons are tarnished. Even Chelsea to this point is now tarnished by a lot of the activity with the Clinton Foundation. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, this lady, it's not important at this point in time in our history to elect the first female president. What is important for our country right now is to elect a president that will put our country back on the path, put our country, you know, make sure that, you know, that the American dream is still obtainable. And I think that is a very strong platform, and I've mentioned this before, that the Republicans could run on. You put her up against, you put anything, you know, to even take Hillary aside, you put her up against anybody that the left has to offer versus what the Republicans, even just what the ones that have declared so far, they don't stand up in comparison at all. And then you still have somebody like Scott Walker who will at some point jump into this race. Even though I'm not a big fan of Jeb Bush by any means, if he is the nominee on the Republican side, I will support him because it would be the lesser of two evils, but he would certainly be far superior as a president of the United States versus Hillary versus, Bernie Sanders, Martin O'Malley, Cuomo from New York, Elizabeth Warren, and heaven forbid Joe Biden, who's yet to, say if he's going to run for president of the United States or not. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, that is why we have to, people often ask, why do I continue to talk about Hillary a lot? And that is why, because each and every single day, something new, a new scandal. The Clintons are just a constant scandal evolving. Their entire life is nothing but a constant scandal. Everything they touch, everything they be, that they are, their very being, every breath is another scandal each and every day. And it's time for the Clintons to go away. It's time for our country to say enough is enough. It's time for Hillary and Bill to go off and retire and enjoy the rest of their lives doing whatever they want to do. But, you know, once again, it's time for new leadership in our country. And certainly there is nothing that our friends on the liberal left, on the Democratic side, have to offer at this point in time that would lead our country back down the path of stability and back down the path of success and leadership in the world today. The United States needs to be the leader of the free world, and this even goes far. You can see now it even goes further beyond just our own country. It goes on to freedom around the world. Well, folks, I have to take a short break, and when we come back, I have a couple of more very interesting stories that I want to discuss with you in the final segment. Once again, you are listening to The Edge of Liberty on WNJC 1360 AM in Philadelphia. We'll be back in about 2.5 minutes.
In a world controlled by corrupt politicians.
You got a business. That you didn't build that.
A team of ordinary men emerge from the ashes to give voice to the voiceless and hope to the hopeless. Sackhead Sean.
Dude, I'm not saying capital is stupid, bro.
Sackhead Clint.
All good friends of ours usually show up drunk.
Also starring Sacco as the producer.
I'm a little bit drunk, I'm a little bit drunk, 'cause I'm drinking.
They are the Sackheads Radio Show. Every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific on shrmedia.com.
I'm Jason Miller from the Evan Miller Report. Each weeknight, I take you around the world with the latest in world news and politics, not the least of which what's going on in good old Washington, D.C. In short, I'm telling you what the government doesn't want me to.
Join me, Corey Evan, and Jason Miller for the Evan Miller Report, weeknights at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on shrmedia.com. Also on the iHeartRadio app.
This is Tammy Jackson, inviting you to join me on the Tammy Jackson Show every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific on 405radio.com. Put down that remote and tune into the show that covers politics, guns and the Second Amendment, religious liberty, sanctity of life, the military, and more. I host newsworthy guests and work hard to be a conservative radio show that's not like all the others. So save Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific for me, Tammy Jackson, on 405media.com.
I'd like to welcome everybody back to the Edge of Liberty on WNJC 1360 AM. And, of course, I am your host, Dan Butcher, for the day. Sean Lewis is on vacation all through this weekend on Memorial Day. Of course, I will be back with you tomorrow on Friday, which is my normal day to host for Sean. And we will actually have a replay of the Edge of Liberty on Monday. So Sean has picked a really good show for you to listen to. So we hope you tune in for that while you're out there barbecuing. And I'd like to remind everybody, please remember that Memorial Day is so much more than just, you know, cooking out and eating hamburgers. You know, there's actually a reason why we celebrate Memorial Day, and remember the true meaning behind Memorial Day and why we have the opportunity to be able to celebrate and have holidays like that. So especially with your young children, you know, remind them, you know, what the true meaning of Memorial Memorial Day is, why you have family and friends together and celebrating a true great day. I have a couple of few more stories here I'd like to get to before we end today's show, and I do apologize. I'm kind of in one of those days today where I'm kind of flying by the seat of my pants. I had so much going on, so please bear with me. I'm kind of having a struggle getting through the show today, but I think we're doing okay. This is kind of a feel-good story today. So we had a dad who was serving in Afghanistan, and he could not attend his daughter's kindergarten graduation. So this is what happened instead. Okay. Most graduates, whether it be kindergarten, high school, whatever, you know, they invite their family, their close friends, to the graduation. But this one young lady who was graduating kindergarten, since her father could not attend, she had invited the entire local police department to her graduation. Now, her dad, Sean Prinky, is a motorcycle officer and 14-year veteran of the Mesa Police Department. Of course, he's a part-time member of the military. Now, he is also serving in Afghanistan, and he could not attend his daughter Sophie's kindergarten graduation on May 13th. So his fellow Mesa police officers decided to attend the event for him. These are the type of stories with all of the bad press, and a lot of it is warranted. I mean, let's be honest. In every group of people out there, there are some bad apples out there. But a lot of the press and what I have called, we hear a lot of people talking about the war on this, the war on that, but what about the assault that is taking place on our police officers today, the constant attack that they are under, the constant pressure that they are under? We have an administration that thinks that they are evil incarnated and is constantly criticizing police officers across the country. When basically they live in our communities. They're just like us. They're our friends. They're our neighbors. They're our family. They have kids in our school. So they're just like us. They just, being a police officer is their job. And it is a job that takes a very special person to do. It is a job that I could not do personally. And I have friends that are police officers. I have a brother that is a fireman. But these are jobs that take very special people, a special dedication, a calling, just like the military. I'm one to believe that, people that become police officers, they see this as a calling. They're called to do this. They don't see it as just a job. They see it as a mission, something very important, very dear to them. Being police officer is a very hard life. It's very hard on people individually. It's very hard on their families because of everything that's involved. And then you put on top of the vicious attacks that we see on our police officers in the liberal media by our own president. It is, it's refreshing when we get to report good, positive news like this. I love reporting on my website, my own website, whenever I see something about police officers, when we get the videos of them helping out kids, fixing their bikes on the street, when we can get some video or pictures of them playing and working with the kids in the neighborhoods, talking with the people and interacting, and stuff like that. It's really wonderful to get these type of stories. This quote comes from Mesa Police Detective Esteban Flores, who said, "The graduation ceremony event was put together by a fellow Mesa Police Department officer and a friend of his whose wife is also a teacher at the same school. They worked together with the school and with Prinky's Motor Squad to make it happen." So this is my feel-good story of the day, and it's so wonderful to see this. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you see one of the police officers in your community and you happen to see them in a convenience store or happen to see them somewhere, please take the time to say thank you. Say thank you. You would not believe how far that would go in helping make their day. just say a simple thank you for everything that they do for our communities. The Boy Scouts of America, and this is a story that I wrote on Pundit Press, have decided to ban water balloons and water gun fights. Yes, once again, let me clarify that headline for you. The Boy Scouts of America have decided to ban water balloons and water gun fights. Now, this is just more summertime fun that's being taken away in the name of political correctness, ladies and gentlemen. Beginning this summer, the Boy Scouts of America, like I mentioned, have announced a ban on water balloons and water gun fights. Now, page 99 of the 2015 Boy Scout Handbook now states, water guns and rubber band guns must only be used to shoot at targets, and eye protection must be worn. So if you've got a water gun, you have to wear eye protection now if you're a Boy Scout. Now, page 100 of the handbook states, for water balloons, use small biodegradable balloons and fill them no larger than a ping pong ball. And, of course, this is getting absolutely ridiculous. The Michigan Crossroads Council of Boy Scouts of America, which serves more than 68,000 scouts statewide, is in full support of this ban. And this is what they had to say. Our mission is to prepare young people for life, and part of that duty is to ensure our youth become civically minded adults. Pointing a simulated firearm at another individual is not aligned with our scout oath nor scout law. We can understand some may feel this ban is extreme, but preparing young people for life starts in a child's most impressionable years. We are committed to our mission here statewide, locally, and nationally. And that came from Crossroads Marketing and Communications Director Carrie Mitchell. Now, the rules were originally exposed by Brian Wendell, who in a blog post on Scouting Magazine, on the Scouting Magazine Report magazine website, stated, he said, why the rule? A scouter once told me this explanation I liked quite a lot. A scout is kind. What's part of pointing a firearm, simulated or otherwise, at someone is kind. And, of course, Wendell is the senior editor of Boys Live, Scouting, and Eagles Call magazines. Now, not surprisingly, this rule is not setting very well with a few people. Here's some of the quotes that have hit social media. What a load of political correct crap. What's the point of super soakers if you don't shoot them at others to get wet and cool off on a hot day? And water balloons no bigger than a ping pong ball? Have you ever been hit by a water balloon that isn't big enough to explode? It hurts more than one that's properly filled. Here's another comment. This is a load of BSA garbage. Another person said, Sometimes I just have to laugh out loud at how idiotic some things in our society have become. We can't squirt each other with water guns because it's, quote, a simulated gun. I can't believe the Boy Scouts of America is so worried about the PC police that it has a policy like this. And another commenter had this to say. Yet, let's carry every policy to the absurd extreme that will certainly help scouts shed that geeky image. This is political correctness run amok, ladies and gentlemen, on steroids. Well, you know, no surprise here. So far, nobody has called in to take me up on my challenge to name one positive accomplishment by Hillary Clinton, not only as Secretary of State, but in her entire political career. So you now have 6 minutes to take me up on my challenge. Once again, that number is area code 516-666-9999. 1-800-273-9908. I have one more story real quick I want to get to before we end today's show. And then if we have somebody call, we'll get to them real quick. The Fairfax County Public Schools have decided to teach their children there is no such thing as, guess what, boys or girls. Yes, you heard that headline right. The Fairfax County Public Schools has decided to teach their children there is no such things as boys or girls. Now, let me put this into perspective for you. Fairfax County Public Schools is one of the largest public school systems in our country, and it's now adding gender identity lessons to its classroom curriculum. For those of you that don't know where Fairfax County Public School System is, it's kind of on the outskirts of Washington, D.C., kind of in the Arlington, Virginia area, kind of around in there. So you can see how large of an area this is. Now, in this additional curriculum, will be taught in grades 7 through 12, and will include lessons on sexual fluidity and spectrum, which teaches there is no such thing as being 100% boy or girl. Quote, the students will be provided definitions for sexual orientation terms, heterosexuality, homosexuality, and bisexuality, and their gender identity term, transgender. Emphasis will be placed on recognizing that everyone is experiencing changes and the role of respectful, inclusive language in promoting an environment free of bias and discrimination. Individual identity will be described as having four parts: biological gender, gender identity, which includes transgender, gender role, and sexual orientation, which includes heterosexual, bisexual, and homosexual. Emphasis will be placed on an understanding that there is a broader, boundless, and fluid spectrum of sexuality that is developed throughout a lifetime. Sexual orientation and gender identity terms will be discussed with focus on appreciation for individual differences, the district said about the gender identity curriculum. Now, with this curriculum, seventh graders will learn about transgenderism. 10th grade students will be taught that sexuality is a broader spectrum. 8th graders will be taught that individual identity, quote, occurs over a lifetime and includes the component of sexual orientation and gender identity according to the curriculum. Now, I want to give this quote. This quote came from FCPS School Board Chair Tamara Koufax to Pundit Press. Who said, the decision by the school board to add gender identity to our non-discrimination policy is to provide an environment which promotes equality, which every student and employee is treated with dignity and respect. This tells our students and staff that school and the FCPS workplace are places where they can be safe from harassment and discrimination. The school board has taken the proactive step to protect our students and staff from discrimination. No decisions have yet been made regarding accommodations that will be provided under the revised policy. Our next step will be to hire a consultant to assist in developing appropriate regulations that protect the rights of all students and comply with state and federal law. As decisions are made about how to best protect our students and staff from discrimination, we will take great care to protect the rights and provide for the needs of all students. FCPS will continue to provide the highest quality of education for all students in a safe and caring school communities. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, just like the Boy Scouts, this is political correctness run amok. And I will leave it at that and let you form your own opinion and thoughts on that story that I just gave you, because, ladies and gentlemen, I have actually run out of time with today's show. Once again, nobody called in to take me up on my challenge today to name one single accomplishment that Hillary Clinton has had during her entire political career. No real big surprise there. Well, folks, I am Dan Butcher. You've been listening to The Edge of Liberty from the Time for Heroes studio, part of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, broadcasting from WNJC 1360 AM in Philadelphia. Oh, I will be back with you again, same time, same place tomorrow. Thanks for listening, and God bless.
Hello, I'm Paul, a student at Hillsdale College. Here is my professor, Dr. Larry Arn, on the separation of church and state.
America's founders believed in a separation of church and state, in that the country was not to have an official religion or an official sect. But that did not mean that government was to be hostile to religion, or even indifferent to religion, as many today argue. In fact, America's founding document, the Declaration of Independence, includes both a reference to God as the author of the laws of nature and a confident assertion that human beings are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. Far from being hostile or indifferent to religion, America's founders understood the theology of the Declaration to be an essential part of the education of citizens.
This Constitution Minute was brought to you by Hillsdale College. To join the national conversation on the Constitution, go to constitutionminute.org.
In a world controlled by corrupt politicians.
You got a business. That, you didn't build that.
A team of ordinary men emerge from the ashes to give voice to the voiceless and hope to the hopeless. Sackhead Sean.
Dude, I'm not saying Kaffir was stupid, bro.
Sackhead Clint.
All good friends of ours usually show up drunk.
Also starring Sacco as the producer.
I'm a little bit drunk, I'm a little bit drunk, cause I'm drinking, drinking, drinking.
They are the Sackheads Radio Show. Every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Pacific on shrmedia.com.
20,000 comedies over the river. You know the bridge. We can't defend Donha.
We will fly in Donha, and we will die in Donha.
This is not a prison. This is the re-education camp.
The communists always try to break us.
Bring teachers here to teach you. Proper communist way to live.
Still show no gratitude! Get up!
But they will never break me.
Ride the Thunder, coming soon to a theater near you. For more information, visit RideTheThunderMovie.com.